गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर विनोद जी।
गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर साहब।
ऐसे है सर?
बस ठीक है।
ठीक।
मैंने बोला था कि आपकी जॉइनिंग सेकंड है, 1 डेज माइनस हुआ था, उसको 29 डेज करना पड़ेगा। तो सर ये सिग्नेचर जो आपने किया है, इसको सर एक बार ट्रेस करना पड़ेगा, नहीं तो उन्होंने बोला कि यहाँ आपसे दिखवा के सिग्नेचर।
गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर प्रभु, वेलकम।
गुड आफ्टरनून, गुड आफ्टरनून,
गुड आफ्टरनून सर, डॉक्टर प्रभु, गुड आफ्टरनून,
गुड आफ्टरनून।
डॉक्टर प्रभु सर, गुड आफ्टरनून,
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून, हाउ आर यू?
गुड आफ्टरनून सर,
गुड आफ्टरनून,
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून,
गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर प्रभु।
नमस्ते सर।
नमस्ते।
ठीक लग रहे हैं, अच्छे लग रहे हैं सर।
एवर यंग, एवर यंग।
तीन मिनट्स आगे थे कि प्राय ऐसे गए थे।
Good afternoon to all.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Dr. Rajendra Prasad.
Good afternoon, sir. कैसे हैं?
Congratulations, face to face.
Thank you, sir.
किस खुशी में? Congratulations.
He joined director ISRI, you know.
Oh, congrats, Rajendra. Congrats. Congrats, congrats, bhai.
Thank you.
Very good. Long due. Eh?
Thank you.
We can start, Dr. Rashmi.
Sir, if you permit, sir. It's still, sir, 2 minutes are there, sir.
Okay.
Anil, how are you? Anil Dahuja.
Good afternoon.
Very good afternoon. How are you?
Fine, sir.
कैसे चल रहा है काम अभी?
बढ़िया सर.
बढ़िया चल रहा है? Continuing with the same, हाँ?
Yeah.
Barinwal sir, namaste.
Dr. Barinwal. Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Very good afternoon. Hi, Vinod. Congrats on your wonderful paper. Very good. Keep it up. Keep the flag high. Flying high. Hi, DK. How are you? अनम्यूट करो, अनम्यूट करो। डीके, अनदर डीके। अनिल, वेलकम।
नमस्कार सर।
नमस्ते, नमस्ते।
चल भाई।
गुड आफ्टरनून तुषार। एसपी आप बिल्कुल इसमें अंधेरे में बैठे हैं।
सर नमस्ते सर।
नमस्ते, आपके ऊपर लाइट नहीं आ रहा।
हाय
हिमांशु,
गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून हिमांशु।
नमस्कार नमस्कार नमस्कार।
ओ नमस्ते सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून सर। गुड आफ्टरनून सर प्रशु वर्मा, वेलकम।
गुड आफ्टरनून सर, नमस्ते नमस्ते। अनम्यूट करिए सर।
अनम्यूट सर, अनम्यूट कर लीजिए सर। अनुपम वर्मा सर।
ओहो, गुड आफ्टरनून
डॉक्टर अनुपम सर।
आह, गुड टू सी यू। या
सर, गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून ब्रदर। क्या हाल है भाई?
ठीक है सर, बढ़िया।
और प्रभु जी बताइए
सर,
क्या हो रहा है?
ठीक हो रहा सर।
गुणगान करो
जो आपकी मर्जी।
हेलो, तो ये
आफ्टरनून शैली।
हेलो
रश्मि, वी कैन स्टार्ट नाउ
सर। आई थिंक वी शुड स्टार्ट सर। ये
रश्मि, गुड मॉर्निंग
जी सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून
डॉक्टर। गुड आफ्टरनून सर। गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर बर्मन, शुड वी स्टार्ट?
Yes, madam, we are ready.
Yes, you're ready. Yes.
Esteemed dignitaries, faculty, and dear students, a very good afternoon to one and all. On behalf of Postgraduate School, Indian Agricultural Research Institute, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to the Agricultural Education Day lecture program. Agricultural Education Day is being celebrated every year on this day to commemorate the birth anniversary of first President of Independent India and Union Minister of Agriculture, Bharat Ratna Dr. Rajendra Prasad. The motive of this day is to create awareness on various facets of agriculture and its importance in the country's economy and development among the students, particularly school students, and nurture their interest in agriculture and allied subjects. So let's begin the program with an invocation to Goddess Saraswati.
Hey,
Mama.
Oh,
I would now request Dr. Rashmi Agarwal, Dean and Joint Director of Education, IRA, to extend a very warm welcome to all the dignitaries. Madam.
Thank you, Harita. Most respected Professor S.L. Mehtaji, former Vice Chancellor, Maharana Pratap University of Agriculture Technology, Udaipur, and former DDG Education, ICR, and distinguished speaker of today's function, our most dynamic leader, Dr. A.K. Singh, Director IRI and Chairman of today's function, Dr. K.V. Prabhu, Chairperson PPVFRA, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who is Director ISRI, Dr. V.K. Singh, Joint Director Extension IRI, Dr. D.K. Yadav, ADG Seeds ICR and also Head Division of Seed Science and Technology, directors of the Outreach Program Institutes connected with IRA, I can see Dr. Himanshu Pathak, Director NIESM Baramati, former directors and DDGs and Vice Chancellors, Dr. P. Das is there, Dr. H.S. Gupta, he recently joined, Professor Anupam Verma, Dr. H.S. Gore, former Dean, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and also, I would like to address scientists, professors, head of the divisions. On this occasion, this afternoon, I welcome you all to celebrate Agricultural Education Day lecture, which is being celebrated through online mode. Knowledge, education, morality, ethics, social commitment, and philosophy, they have infinite dimensions. These attributes differentiate humans from all other living organisms on this earth. How these are practiced makes a difference and guides the direction of the world towards betterment. Today, we have gathered here to celebrate the Agricultural Education Day so as to pay homage to the first President of India, who was also the first Union Agriculture Minister, Bharat Ratna, late Dr. Rajendra Prasad ji, whose birthday falls on 3rd December. On this occasion of Agricultural Education Day, it is a matter of great privilege for all of us to most profusely welcome Professor S.L. Mehta ji, who has been very kind enough to accept our invitation to speak on quality of agricultural education holds the key to agricultural transformation. We are very delighted to see you, sir, and we welcome from the core of our heart to this occasion. We feel privileged to welcome Dr. Ashok Kumar Singh, Director IRI, Chairman of today's function. I also most cordially welcome all the distinguished dignitaries, directors of the sister institutions, ex-directors and deans, project directors, heads of the divisions, project coordinators, professors, faculty members, staff, students, and other guests who have joined to this function. On this occasion, I wish to say a few words about the towering personality in whose memory we are celebrating this Agricultural Education Day. Dr. Rajendra Prasad was born on 3rd December 1884 in Siwan district of Bihar. His father was a scholar of both Sanskrit and Persian languages. Dr. Prasad did MA in economics from University of Calcutta in 1907, and he did Master's in Law in 1915 and won a gold medal. Subsequently completed his doctorate in law from Allahabad University in 1937. Dr. Prasad served in various educational institutions as a teacher. Upon independence in 1947, Dr. Prasad was elected as President of the Constituent Assembly of India and prepared the Constitution of India. He traveled the world extensively as an ambassador of India, building diplomatic rapport with foreign nations. He was re-elected for two consecutive terms in 1952 and 1957, and is the only president of India to achieve this feat. The Mughal gardens at the Rashtrapati Bhavan were open to public for about a month for the first time during his tenure. And since then, it has been a big attraction for people in Delhi and other parts of the country. It's an illustrious son of India. Dr. Rajendra Prasad encouraged the development of education in India. So we are very fortunate and very delighted to celebrate this day on 3rd December every year. So with these words, I welcome you all once again on this occasion. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, madam. On the occasion of Agriculture Education Day, PG School has organized a debate competition in the forenoon on a very interesting topic. Studying agriculture at school level will revitalize higher agricultural education. Active participation was observed from the PG students at IRI, and they were evaluated by a judging committee headed by Dr. Shelley Praveen, Head Division of Biochemistry, and members Dr. D.K. Singh, Professor Agricultural Engineering, and Dr. R.N. Padaria, Professor Agricultural Extension. I request a virtual presentation of certificates to the top three performers as a mark of appreciation and encouragement. First prize was bagged by Ms. Simardeep Kaur, first year PhD student from the Division of Biochemistry. Second prize was shared between Ms. Pankhuri Singhal, PhD student from the Division of Plant Pathology, and Mr. Mayank Tiwari, MSc student from SESCRA. Mr. Ankit Mahapatra, MSc student from the Division of Agricultural Extension, won the third prize. Congratulations to the winners and all the participants. May now request our beloved Director and Vice Chancellor IRA, Dr. A.K. Singh, to introduce the eloquent speaker of today's lecture, Professor S.L. Mehta, Vice Chancellor, Maharana Pratap University of Agriculture and Technology, Udaipur, and former DDG Education, ICR.
Thank you, Harita, the visionary educationist and teacher par excellence, and the speaker of today's lecture, Professor S.L. Mehta, Professor H.S. Gupta, former director, IRI, Professor Anupam Verma, former dean, Professor H.S. Gaur, former dean, IRI, Dr. K.B. Prabhu, Professor Das, and all my colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen. It's my proud privilege to welcome Professor S.L. Mehta as speaker of today's session. He is so well known to each one of us. I really don't need to tell about Dr. Mehta to this audience. But I must say that he is an educationist par excellence. The kind of reform that he brought to agricultural education system is unparalleled. After doing his, intermediate in agriculture, today when we find that agriculture from basic education, primary education is disappearing, there is hardly any institution in the country where agriculture at high school level, intermediate level is being taught, and that's one of the reasons that people do not get so much motivated. When I was going through his early education career, I found Dr. Mehta did his intermediate in agriculture. Then after doing BSc Agriculture, MSc and PhD in IRI, he did his postdoc from University of Alberta, came back and joined the division at 1972. He was one of the youngest professors in the subject. Then he built the Department of Biochemistry to international level, following in the footprint of his predecessors. In research, his contribution on development of low BOA containing Lithyrus lines, Pusha Ratan, is a landmark contribution. That is still one of the variety is developed through somaclonal variation, which is in the low BOA content line, one of the most prominent lines, is still cultivated. For some time there was a ban, and when the ban was lifted, this was the one line with low content that was picked up for a large scale commercialization. And we are doing seed production in large scale. Then as Dean of the PG school at IRI and then DDG Education, he brought so much a focus on human resource development that is unparalleled. And many of us who are sitting in this group have been direct beneficiary. I remember Professor Mehta as DDG Education, Dr. Anupam Verma as Dean, picked up very bright, teachers, likely teachers from the young lot, and they were sent for Agriculture Human Resource Development Program in US and many other universities. And on coming back, people have made a tremendous contribution to teaching and taking teaching to a higher pedestal at IRI. Likewise, his contribution in National Agricultural Technology Project, NATP, bringing a lot of support from World Bank and closely monitoring these projects has been very, very fruitful. And then he served as Vice Chancellor of Maharana Pratap University of Agriculture Science and Technology, his alma mater where he did his BSc Agriculture. And there again, he brought so much of connectivity with the farmers, with the Krishi Vigyan Kendras, connecting agriculture education to the grassroots level. That was something remarkable. People remember him a lot for his great contribution. He also served as the resident advisor to Advanced Center for Agriculture Research and Education in Myanmar, which IRI, with the help of Ministry of External Affairs and ICR, developed this center. And this is again a landmark contribution in terms of establishing the relationship between Myanmar and India, in a way paying back to our legendary Professor B.P. Pal, who got his education master's degree from Verma University. And then now our teachers are going to Myanmar and they are teaching regularly. And he also initiated larger fellowship program, and the students are coming from there for PhD program at IRI and greatly benefited. Many of them have gone back and they have started the work in a very systematic manner and also. We are indeed grateful to you, sir, for kindly agreeing to deliver this Agriculture Education Day lecture at IRI. I would like to welcome you once again and welcome each one of you wholeheartedly. Thank you very much.
I would now request Professor Mehta, sir, to please present his lecture.
Sir, unmute, sir. Yes, thank you, sir.
Distinguished Director IRE, Dr. K. Singh, Dr. Rashmi Agarwal, Dean and Joint Director IRE, Dr. P. Das, former DDG Extension, Dr. H. S. Gupta, former Director IRE, Dr. Anupam Verma, my colleague, Dr. Prabhu, Dr. Pathak, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Dr. Yadav, distinguished heads of the divisions, professors, faculty members, distinguished guests who are participating in virtual mode, students, ladies and gentlemen. I deem it a privilege and honor to deliver this lecture. Let me just put on my screen. I deem it a privilege and honor to deliver Agriculture Education Day lecture, which is planned to commemorate the birthday of the first agriculture minister of the interim government and the first president of India, Bharat Ratna, Dr. Rajendra Prasad. Besides being great freedom fighter and a scholar, Dr. Rajendra Babu was champion of farmers and was drafted by Gandhiji to help in campaign to improve the condition of peasants exploited by British indigo planters in Bihar. He was also a champion of education development in India for building new India. It is therefore befitting that IRE has instituted lecture in Dr. Rajendra Prasad's memory, and Director IRE deserves congratulations. Government of India has recently approved new education policy for the country, which aims at education quality enhancement. It is a landmark policy with far-reaching recommendations. If implemented in the spirit in which these recommendations have been made, we can expect a substantial improvement in education, which will propel standing of Indian education globally to a higher platform. I have chosen to speak today on the journey of quality enhancement of agriculture education by ICAR and what needs to be done. We could have sense of pride in our achievements so far, but the journey is still long, and I am confident that enough efforts will be made as articulated in the new education policy for addressing some of the key concerns for quality enhancement. Immediately after independence, the government gave importance to agriculture. Our first Prime Minister, Sri Jawaharlal Nehru, said, "Everything can wait, but not agriculture." We were importing about 10 to 11 million tons of food grains every year, especially under 480 program of USA. This weakness was used politically to put pressure on the government, but this did not last long. The sound policies pursued by the government of India, development of human resource to lead technology development with demonstration and high receptivity of the farming community, ushered in green revolution. The outcome was that India became self-sufficient in food grains in a very short time. This success was admired and acknowledged all over the world. However, agriculture now faces far more new challenges than ever before. The younger generation's interest in farming will subside due to diminishing returns from agriculture. The reasons for lower income from farming is due to decline in factor of productivity, climate change, degrading natural resources, especially land and water, and biotic and abiotic stress limiting crop productivity. So how do we meet this challenge in the light of new developments in the field of agriculture? Future agriculture will be more technology intensive. Artificial intelligence in agriculture will boost this sector using powerful computer vision technology to train machines for better production in agro farming. Agriculture yield boosting algorithms for maximizing crop yields are being developed. It is imperative that to take advantage of these new developments and for keeping pace with technology development, which is essential to strengthen quality of higher agriculture education. Obviously, it will require higher investment to fulfill this goal. I'm going to describe the developments in higher agriculture education and how have we met these challenges by generating qualified human resource. Just one full screen. Full screen. Full screen. Is it in full screen?
Not yet, sir. Not yet, sir. You have to put in slides. So
yeah, is it okay?
Yeah, now it is okay.
Yeah. If you look at growth of agriculture, we see that from a mere production of 51 million tons in 1951, we have a record production of 291.9 million tons, which is almost six-fold increase in food grain production. And this is not only true only for food grain production, but we have also increased pulses production to almost 23.4 million tons. And for a very long time, our pulses were stagnating at 14 to 15 million tons. The same is the story that we are now number one producer of milk in the world with about 187.7 million tons, which is more than 11-fold increase in milk production. Same is true for fish production, which has gone to 13.7 million ton, which is again about 15-fold increase in production. In oil seed production, we are a little short, still we are importing, but still we have achieved 34.1 million ton. In fruit and vegetables, the increase has been phenomenal. In fact, the total horticulture production has surpassed the production of food grains. And today we can see in every village throughout India, availability of fruits and vegetables to people. It is an irony that despite such a substantial increase in food grain production, there is still malnutrition. It's also gratifying to note that our scientists have risen to challenge. And on the World Food Day, our Honorable Prime Minister released 17 biofortified crop varieties, which have improved nutritional quality in rice, wheat, maize, minor millets, and mustard, groundnut, and also in yam. High zinc wheat, again with 40 ppm, has been released. So people who have zinc deficiency can take this. In fact, there has been an effort by many of our scientists in different institutes to develop varieties which are nutritionally have high quality. The same is true for vegetables. There are high anthocyanin, high beta carotene varieties have been developed, and this is going to change a total pattern for not only consumption, but at least removing many of the nutritional problems that are prevalent in our population. Cradle of the success of increasing food grain production, developing the nutritional varieties, is that we built very good institutions, universities, ICR institutes, the institutes which developed human resources, qualified human resources, the human resources which were developer of new technology, and not only developer of new technology, but disseminating this to the farming community. If we look at the first agriculture university was set up in 1960 at Pannagar, and subsequently to that, by 8th plan, we had 28 SAUs. And today, the number of universities in the country is almost 75. This has increased substantially. And this, with the increase in the number of universities, the enrollment of students have also gone up. One situation which has come is that when universities was established early on in 1960s to 1970, most state governments were claiming to have universities. In fact, Cummings' report made it clear that only those states can be given agriculture university which transfer research stations to the university. And therefore, at that time, almost all state governments agreed, and that is why we have trinity of function: education, research, and extension. And because of that, most universities were developed very well. In fact, both campuses in terms of infrastructure, and they really made a major contribution in developing human resources. In terms of constituent colleges, by 8th plan, we had only 196 colleges. Now we have almost 400 colleges. And it's my guess that in next 10 years, we would have almost about 500 colleges. And these colleges are across disciplines. There are almost 11 strong disciplines at undergraduate level, which have been developed depending upon the need. One of the advantages of spreading of these colleges and universities has been that students have now opportunity to go for higher agriculture education in very large number. ICR, right from the beginning, has supported for quality enhancement support. In fact, ICR provides development grant, which have been increased very substantially 8th plan onward. In fact, during 8th plan, I was a DDG education. Our budget was a meager 11 crore. And that year itself, in just 3 months, we raised it to 39 crore by fighting with Planning Commission. And I must admire Dr. R.S. Paroda. At that time, he was DG. And he met with all our demands, and that became a springboard for increasing the funding for state agriculture universities. In fact, we came up with catch-up grant where 400 crores were provided. This was for renovation, for providing state-of-the-art lecture halls, niche area of excellence by ICR, experiential learning units, almost 400 experiential learning units, each with the investment of crore and more than 1 crore. State-of-the-art infrastructure was developed. Faculty training, summer schools, winter schools, we increased substantially the number. ICR came up with a lot of scholarships, GRF, SRF, and this scholarship amount were increased. Then ECRIP and Home Science supported substantially development of home science colleges in the country. Now the state universities which were established, as I said, they were established on land grant pattern of US. We had Trinity of Function, Education, Research and Extension. And this was a little distinct from other universities because other universities don't have extension. Some of the universities have much less emphasis on research. Universities early on were multidisciplinary and unicampus. For example, Pandnagar, PAU, even at that time, Udaipur, OUAT, all came as a single campus universities, but with the varying demands and meeting the aspirations of people in different regions, colleges and universities have been opened, which are uni-discipline. Although we oppose this uni-discipline universities, and I'm very happy that the education policy makes a very strong case now that all universities will have to be multidisciplinary by 2030. So I'm hoping that many of these disadvantages we have of single discipline universities will give way to multidisciplinary universities by at least in times to come. All state universities, as I said, funded very good financial support, which now is almost very little. So I'll come to that. And this opening of these various institutions, universities, colleges, allowed this access to higher education to more number of students. And in fact, in last about 10 years, private universities have come forward in starting agriculture, science, different discipline colleges. And I think that's, again, a good development. The only part is that we must look at quality assurance by these new campuses. I must say that ICR also established following the leadership of IRE, IVRE, NDRE, and CFE became deemed to be universities. And they have a unique contribution in developing qualified human resource in technology generation and dissemination of technology and income enhancement of the farming community, major contributors of green, white, and blue revolutions. I must say now that these institutions should be provided full autonomy and institutional autonomy as propounded in our new education policy. And of course, this should go with accountability. One of the suggestions I wish to make is that there should be no transfers to these institutions. There are still, despite the gains that we have made so far in terms of increasing food and production and all other horticulture production, whether milk production, all agriculture commodities, there is still a pressure, continued pressure on increasing production. Because by 2050, it is estimated that we'll have 1.7 billion people. So to feed this population, we shall have to increase food grain production. Then eradicating malnutrition and poverty is a very important goal. And agriculture plays a very substantial role in this. And we have to produce more with little water. With 4.2% water, we have to support 16% population of the world. Climate mitigation and resilience is again going to be a very major challenge. Reducing post-harvest losses and increased processing and value addition for higher income to farmers would be another important challenge. Sustainability, environmental protection, and increased income from farming will be very important. Now let us look at some realities about our education as of today. There are enhanced expectation of the people from agriculture education. All solutions or problems of agriculture have to be addressed by us. And this is against a milieu when the financial support is dwindling. All universities are facing resource crunch. In fact, everybody has been asked to earn your own money. And by nature, our agriculture universities have been very small universities, hardly 1,000 students on roll in university. And there is not much cushion to increase fees to get higher resources. Some universities are lucky that they have a large land, like Pandnagar, 20,000 hectares of land. They can really raise resources, but there are others are not like the university which came later, don't have enough land. And therefore, every university has to now start totally commercially as to how do we raise this money. Globalization and breaking of communication barriers are giving us a lot of new alternatives. And therefore, every institution will have to think, how do we remain ahead of all others? Lack of autonomy and poor governance is another concern. Although we have universities, but most universities, I would say, they are under governmental control and tighter control. When I say tighter control, even there are acts which can put vice chancellor under real stress because of the financial control. There is extensive inbreeding. In fact, ICR, we did taking advantage of HRD project. We introduced a lot of steps for reducing inbreeding. But when it comes to individual institutions, SAUs, I think we are not wedded to this reducing inbreeding, because that quality enhancement is not uppermost in our agenda. In general, I'm talking about in general, faculty competence neglect. You know, when initially the universities were established, we were very fortunate that they had a twinning arrangement. You know, early on, five universities like Pannagar, University at Udaipur, Ludhiana, OUAT, all had a partnership with one of the universities in USA. So faculty went in large numbers to these universities for training, both for getting even PhD, for short-term or long-term training. And when they came, they really made a remarkable contribution in teaching improvement and also in research guidance. And this part, we are fortunate in ICR that through various projects, we have somewhat provided this opportunity of training of faculty. And Professor Singh mentioned that during NATP, we sent almost 34 professors, not professors, the best teachers identified by students in IRI overseas. The idea was that best teachers should go to the best of the institution, so that when they come back, our only one request was that when you come back, do the same kind of teaching that you see in USA. And I think this is what really made a somewhat difference at that time. And this program, we need to really continue if we want to improve the quality of our teaching. There have to be a movement of faculty from one institution to other. Research quality, output, and relevance. These are the three. There's partly a question mark. We have done well, but we have a potential to do much more. The idea is not we congratulate people who have really done very well, but with the kind of mass numbers we have, we still have a long way to go. There is a, as propounded in our education, education policy, there is an inadequate mechanism for merit-based career management and progression of faculty and institutional leaders. You know, this is another area which has to be taken care. We all know that academic excellence holds key to global competitiveness, technology generation, research excellence, leadership in science, meeting the objectives of agriculture policy, innovation, and quality assurance. Quality assurance has been, in fact, advocated and implemented by ICR through, we are very fortunate that we had several World Bank funded projects. The first one was HRD project from 1995 to 2000. In that, at that time, we set up an accreditation board in 1996. And this accreditation board was set up for quality assurance so that we conform to minimum standards of education. We did initiate steps for reducing inbreeding, moving students from one university to another, making a proposition that all three degrees should not be from the same university. Then we supported infrastructure development. At least at that time, four universities got substantial support. So they were really had a state-of-the-art infrastructure. Curriculum revision, ICR has a very good method of curriculum revision of by instituting various deans committee. We have so far five deans committee for revising this core curriculum. And it has all deans committee have done a wonderful job. Faculty training under World Bank HRD project, we sent almost about 800 scientists overseas at that time. the computerization under AIDS was started, which we strengthened under HRD. The other major reforms were, we were the first in the country to introduce National Talent Scholarship. You know, Government of India provided National Talent Scholarship much earlier, but that was restricted to only a very small number. Just for our agriculture students at that time, we provided for a scholarship for 1,500 students, by far the largest number. And not only that, we put a condition that for availing this National Talent Scholarship, students have to move from the state of domicile, so that there is a interstate movement of a student. Then we organize the All India Competitive Examination for admission to 15% seats at UG and 25% seats at PG level. And this really changed the milieu at state agriculture universities. You know, when the students move from one place to another, it put pressure on local students to perform. And therefore, there were a lot of strikes and students used to bunk classes. This became a thing of past. JRF and SRF, we increased substantially, not only the number, but we also increased the amount at that time. As I said, for quality assurance, the accreditation board was established. New accreditation project was developed, taking advantage of our own system, taking advantage of United States system, UK system, all over the world. And we came out what was the best for agriculture education, because we have teaching, education, research, and extension. So it had to be a little different than what NAAQ prescribes. We also set at that time norms and standards for quality education, uniformity in academic regulation. Now again, some people took this to a very far-fetched level. The idea of academic regulation was a minimum standards. It was not that everybody has to be same, you know, like there has been a pressure on IRE, why it can't shift from trimester to semester. I think this is not the idea of uniformity. Idea of uniformity is for quality enhancement. It's not, every institution should have freedom, autonomy, how they want to do it, the way the best they can do it. Governance and personal policies are most important, but I must say they are the least attended in the sense that what is decided, when people go back, they revert back to this. You know, I'll give a classical example of, we wanted to decentralize powers, you know, the powers relating to the support provided by ICAR. And when this decentralization was done, a lot of people issued orders, but told the officers, don't to go by that. You have to send the files again upward. You know, this is a kind of thing which happens, but I think we'll have to hammer it out. In terms of assessment, we still have a little lacuna that we don't have that rigor in assessment. I think if for having a quality assurance, the assessment should have a rigor for both public and private institutions. Under NATP and NIP, again, we went for a substantial computerization, governance, delegation of powers. You know, for example, I think everybody was happy at that time that all PIs had full power to execute their projects. I think, and that is carried, that kind of a powers are even carried even now, but some have reverted back. You know, after the closure of these projects, people have reverted back. Massive infrastructure development, digitization, libraries. This was again a massive job done at that time. Development of e-learning modules for UG. One of the best UG e-learning modules were developed in veterinary. I can say they are the best in the world anywhere because we provided them training, provided them support. Internet access, we were the first to provide, connect all universities and regional stations throughout, I remember. This was done in one day by Dr. Mangalar. I want to give him full credit. In one meeting, he told FA, aaj aap kuch baat nahi karenge. Aaj Mehta ji jo keh rahe hain, wo ek minute mein isko pass karenge. 25 crores were spent, were agreed in just 5 minutes. And immediately we implemented within 3 months, all institutions were networked. Then we came up with CERA, the Consortia for E-Resources in Agriculture. Again, a bold step by ICAR. In providing access to latest information by all scientists and students, community. Teamwork, value chain with different partners was inculcated in NAIP. This was another major initiative taken. under NHEP, which is currently being implemented, is again another world-being project whose objective is to improve the quality and relevance of agriculture education and research towards agriculture transformation. The institutional development plan, it has infrastructure development, faculty. The good part added is the student training as well. Almost 300 students have already gone to base of the institutions, and many more will go as with the remaining time. Twinning of universities, the universities are tying up. You have a freedom to twin with the best of the universities anywhere, whether it's outside or in India. This is a good one. Establishing centers for advanced agriculture science and technology, innovation grants, institutional reforms for improving effectiveness of ICAR, because ICAR has responsibility of coordinating agriculture education, and therefore there's a very strong support provided for that. Better governance and management is another buzzword. In my view, there are reforms which are now required. One is autonomy. I think we talk about autonomy, but we don't want to give autonomy. And I think this it should be very clearly defined autonomy. I have, in fact, said to every DG who came, I said, provide full autonomy to my, at least these four DUs, because in ICAR, of course, in ICUs, we can't help it, but we can work with the state governments to bring this. But now with the new education policy, this autonomy is inbuilt, very strongly built, and I hope this is taken in the spirit in which it has been made now. Improving university administration, delegation, decentralization. I think leaders who we choose, they should be wedded to this. If they are not wedded, no matter how many orders are passed, how many, what is done, they will never translate it downward. So this is another important human resource management. I must say that in the new education policy, very clear-cut emphasis has been given on choosing leaders of proven competence, leadership, eminence. Now, whether we will be able to do that, that is a dollar question, but let's hope that we can all rise above other considerations and really pick up people. Because you pick one right people, institution looks up. You pick up one wrong person, institution goes down in no time. Building institutions take time, but bringing it down doesn't take much time. Assessment of faculty by student responses and learning outcomes. This is another important area, because many places that I know, if we have to improve substantially, we really must get student responses as to how have they seen and what are the learning outcomes. Because we have never looked at learning outcomes. We have looked at, okay, courses, finish, go. Digital university, e-governance, another area. One of the major change which ICAR did was introducing experiential learning. Fourth Dean Committee made recommendation, and almost so far, almost 650 crores have been spent in developing these experiential learning units. And these are the kind of learning units which, you know, you aspire to see somewhere in a private sector, but we have provided them in our universities in different disciplines to provide high professional competence, practical work experience in real life situation, earn while you learn, and production to consumption project working. The students have to develop a project and look at in a project mode how to do that. Facilitates producing job providers rather than job seekers, contribute to enhance rural livelihood. Now I'm giving this some flavor of the experiential learning units which have come up. These are on high-tech horticulture, beautiful units where students can see best anywhere in the private sector also. This is a kind of apparel unit we have in Udaipur, most modern, computerized for student learning. This is a tomato processing plant, like that other places, mango processing plant, totally automated, students learn about it. And what more can a student aspire? What more can a student want? This kind of training, but the tragedy of the entire program has been that we did not train faculty for this program, because this requires additional input and additional commitment by the faculty. And therefore, much of this program now is more a learning part. It's not in the way the experience learning was envisaged. So I think we will really need to relook at This is the kind of post-harvest technology food processing unit which has come at PAU. Another wonderful units, and such units are not one. I said 466 units in different universities. So this is a kind of another area of biotechnology, I must say, that we really from ICAR and DBT really supported development of biotechnology in this country. And we can have a sense of pride in what has been done. During 1985 to 1987, we developed human resources in biotechnology. In fact, at that time, taking advantage of Tokran, we organized 8 programs, and we had Dr. S. Ramchandran as Secretary DBT, who provided full support for organizing this training at IARI. And we generated almost, during that time, 250 first-rate human resources in biotechnology, who really developed these laboratories at different places, you know. So development of human resource, qualified human resource is the most critical if we want to adopt and adapt new technology for this country. Then sequencing facility jointly supported by ICAR and DBT really enabled ICAR to be a partner in Rice Genome Sequencing Project and brought us international recognition. Capacity building by ICAR and DBT promoted excellence in biotechnology, and our scientists have developed transgenics. It's a different story that because of governmental regulation, we have not been able to take them to the field so far, but day is not far when this will be removed. Of course, biotechnology, I don't have to say, it has a lot of potential, but what I wish to say now, a new technique of genome editing is a revolutionary technique again. This year, Nobel Prize has been given to both the scientists, and this technique is going to change the way we look at development of varieties in times to come. Of course, cotton story is well known. We increase our cotton production more than twofold. Now, the other part that I wish to come to now is vocational and entrepreneurship programs by universities. In fact, I want to compliment ICAR that we have developed a very good system of extension education. KVKs are doing wonderful job on vocational training. I have visited lots of KVK and the kind of support, and Dr. P. Das is here. Dr. P. Das spearheaded the whole program at that time, and it has been followed beautifully by successive DDGs extension. But what is most important now is that need-based market-oriented vocational programs must be taken up by universities. And the new education policy makes a mention of not only vocational program, but also certificate courses, you know. So far, vocational programs are a distinct stream compared to our undergraduate program. But in the new education policy, it has been said that it would be one common program, students streaming upward. So that those who want to drop at 1 year will get a certificate, those who complete 2 years will get a diploma, and those go 3 years, 4 years will get a degree. Now, this would require a total recast of our curriculum. You know, I am finding it difficult how this will be managed, but will have to be managed, and how do we do it? Dr. Singh made a mention in his opening remarks that we don't have agriculture at intermediate level. Rajasthan and UP have colleges which have agriculture at intermediate level. But the irony is that the students who do intermediate in agriculture, they can't get admission to universities, agriculture universities. Reason being that here we take 4 papers, physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology. Now these students, they are taught agriculture, and there is only 1 agriculture paper out of 4. So that students are disadvantaged. Their chemistry and physics is weak. They can't compete. So when it comes to the entrance examination in ICAR, most of the students fail or don't get because they don't have very strong basic background. The deficiency is that in these schools, when you do intermediate 10+2 in agriculture, there are no good physics teachers. There are no good chemistry teachers. There are no, so they are weak. So it's not their fault. It's the fault of the whole education program that we have not taken in a right earnest. So I think while designing agriculture syllabus at the school level, this should be, we'll have to ensure that they also find a place to compete equitably and honorably. Then we will have to meet very demands of private sector, middle level workers will have to be developed. As I said, this capacity building, especially by KVK, I've only shown these two, but in every sector, our KVKs have done a remarkable job, whether it's beekeeping, mushroom production, you name a trade, and they've done it. This is, for example, on tailoring, another on motor rewinding, like that several times. Many of them have got jobs. Many have become entrepreneurs. Many are providing, you know, so such success stories are very many, but we need to really make them more. What is needed now, in my assessment, is that one will have to strengthen our basic sciences. When the first five universities were established, they all had individually a school of basic sciences. And idea was that all agriculture universities will have basic sciences. But subsequently, it became a casualty. Even in these five universities, now basic sciences colleges have become weak because of the reason that we changed our pattern of school education. Earlier, it was 10 plus higher secondary plus undergraduate. Now it is 10 plus 2 plus graduation. Now 10 plus 2 is the stage where we have to have a strong foundation for basic science. But it's well known that that becomes a casualty, especially so when it comes to basic sciences. And therefore, we really need to have in all universities strong centers for basic sciences. The second aspect which is important is because we accepted land grant pattern. Most people do not know that what is this land grant pattern. Under this pattern, under Morrill Act, the idea was that 50% support for education will come from the center in a federal government in USA. 40% will be by the state government, and 10% by fees and other charges will be generated by the university. And in order to provide that 50% support, the federal government gave a lot of land which could be sold. You can create a corpus through which you can support these universities. In India, we thought that you give land. So that's why Pandagar was given 20,000 hectares of land, but other universities were not that fortunate to get that much of land. Now, so here people thought, well, you give land, you forget about it, that the contribution part. So I think it's important now. This crisis for finances has come only after 6th pay commission, and 7th pay commission compounded it. Now, the Sri governments, I always say you are lucky if the Sri governments can pay for salary and pension. Rest of the grant must come from the center. So I think somewhere new education policy propounds this very strongly, that there should be full financial autonomy. In fact, the principle and the manner in which the funds will flow will have to be clearly defined. And once that is defined, the institutions will have autonomy, you know, also an efficiency and quality enhancement. The other important aspect is that we have to build linkages nationally and internationally, both. You know, both are important, exchange of scientists, exchange of students, even joint projects, joint working should be introduced. And for that, whatever support required will need to build in itself. High quality education with equity and inclusion. That's another important part that some sectors should not be left out. So I think we'll have to do that. And this would mean revamping curriculum pedagogy. We'll have to meet different stakeholder demands, industry needs. What kind of needs is required. Communication skills should be upfront, discussion, cross-disciplinary, interdisciplinary thinking and working will be important. Choice-based credit system has been proposed in the new education policy, and it's a good idea to have that, because we tried to introduce this flexible credit system, but the institutions are slow in adopting to this new change. Because everybody, we have a stereotype that we are state jacketed, that this should be a syllabus which is given. I think students should have a choice to take any course in anywhere. You know, you, for example, for undergraduate, we say 160 credits. Okay, you take 160 credits anywhere you like, you know. So they can choose some of the areas that we find today that, you know, But how do we give this area if you don't have a multidisciplinary university? So in my view, bringing back multidisciplinary universities would be another important step for quality enhancement, and also for, I would say, maximizing the impact of the finances that are given. The farmers will have to be globally competitive. This is a buzzword now. You can't have farmers know only about this. They have to really know, and that would require a lot of effort on university system to educate them. Establishment of technology park, again, this is, we were already going with the idea and adopting this. In fact, under NATP and NIP, we have established BPD units in almost 15 universities at that time, and then it was increased to almost 33 universities. And each AVK has also been asked to have a technology park on the farm. Now, this is, I think, the best effort that any institution can do. This is developing joint technology parks for scaling up various technologies that are being developed by our scientists. It provides link between institution and industry. A lot of startup and incubation centers have come. IRA has taken a lead, and almost all other universities have done exceptionally well. And in the process, they are able to generate revenue. Industry and institutional partnership for academic excellence. This we have been doing for a long time. We haven't been able to put in actual practice, but I think time has come when this will have to be taken up front. Sharing of teaching and joint research guidance, you know, internship and implant training. This is being done by few institutions, few universities, but I think it has to be wholesome. It should have to be put in either act or some method of MOU that these students will get facilitated to have that kind of a training. Industry personnel on university research council and vice versa. In fact, the new education policy says a totally a new kind of governance, a board which will take all decisions, and chairman of the board will be from outside. So if we have that, then I think this will be taken care. Industry institutional partnership for bridging technology gap in new and emerging areas, because there are some strengths which the industry has, and we have that weakness, and we have strength in other areas where industry doesn't have. So we can complement each other. It can be a win-win situation for both. Then this COVID pandemic has really put education, both lower and higher education, out of gear. In fact, it has affected the whole world in many ways, human health and many aspects. Now, this crisis also will have to take as an opportunity for radical reforms and realigning our priorities. Technology to play a key role in educating future generations. We can't wait whether the vaccine will come in 6 months or whether a year or 2 years. This is a too long a period. And I think, and our institutions have adapted very well, I must say. And today's this lecture again is a testimony of our, you know, using technology for teaching and continuing what we have started with. So this is so I'm hoping that we will have now, from now on, blended learning, both where is a possible combination of classroom and online module. Each cannot replace another. Now, online module or online teaching, for this, I think we'll have to give training to faculty substantially. Because it is not only online learning, but it is also online assessment. And online assessment, again, has to be very fair, impartial, and also, so a lot of new technology will have to be learned. Collaboration with the organizations which are specialized in digital technology. There are very many private institutions which have that expertise, and we'll have to train faculty there in creating high quality digitized learning content. This is the most critical. Today people say, just like what I'm doing, I take my slides and show it online. That's not the online teaching actually. Online teaching will have to be a totally a different kind of module. Learning anywhere, anytime is going to be a new concept and order. So this is, resilience is to be built in the education system so that in future we are not taken off guard. Right now, everybody has been taken off guard, you know, lockdown for 3 months, then partial withdrawal of lockdown restrictions and so on. So I think we'll have to now be prepared even for tomorrow or any time if some contingencies arise. We are very fortunate in ICER, especially all SAUs and ICER institutes, that we have, I would say, fairly good infrastructure for networking. But this need to be augmented now much more. You know, what we have provided at time was needed in 2002. 2020 is totally different now. Now 5G is going to come, and therefore we'll have to have that investment. So I'm hoping that investment will come. Now, role of educators is to change towards facilitating student development as contributing members of society. You know, that's the most important part which need to be vetted, and this has been also very well articulated. Teaching life skills needed for future, creativity, communication, collaboration, teamwork, emotional intelligence. You know, a lot of people today in the new online teaching, you find they get depressed, you know. So there has to be some kind of a support to them that they don't go into that depression because of the technology inequality. Promotion of open source software, Swayamprabha, Diksha, digital three technology for skill development and for virtual practical labs. That's another going to be most important. If we can't bring them to labs, we can have this 3D technology for virtual, creating virtual lab. Some technologies I'm mentioning, which we started in this laser leveling, we started in NATP. First laser levelers we brought at that time. Now it has become a household technology. Almost everywhere, I traveled in Punjab, Haryana, in UP, I saw hundreds of them. So these have gone. We are also looking at high tech technology. I was recently near Jaipur village, I'm forgetting the name, but almost 150 poly houses in a small village around. Now that's the kind of change which is coming. And the good part is, when you talk to the farmers, they are so grateful to agriculture scientists for help that they are rendering to them in terms of technology. And it's going to change a total canvas everywhere. So I think the new technologies that come, our farmers are very receptive. And they are not only receptive, they are very innovative. You, for example, we give them the kind of technology, they themselves change this technology. So there's a benefit because of that. They are aggregating, they are joining, you know, a lot of new things, developments that are coming, and they are becoming innovative. So it's important that these technologies will go. One technology I wished again is a vertical. I think time has come, our area cannot increase. In fact, what I'm looking at, area is going to decrease because of industrialization, because of urbanization, and also transfer of land to horticulture. You know, despite this change of land to horticulture, our production has increased, but how long? And therefore vertical farming will have to go. This is a beautiful farming for strawberry. I saw vertical 10 pots put one above another. So you have 40 on all four corners, strawberry seedlings, beautiful. Lot of you know, production. So like that, we can really do that. This is a kind of new technologies which is coming up. This is, PAU has already procured it. It leads to increase in yield of 15 to 20%, reduction in nutrient losses to almost 30%, grain yield, moisture sensor. Now, future is going to be an era of sensors. I saw sensors in 89 in USA. I visited this Texas University, Texas A&M. And there the scientists told me that in a cotton field, they can spot out where the insect is, and the spray will be done only on that insect, not on the whole crop. So when I came back, I put a proposal that we should really tie up with IITs and other institutions to develop sensors in India. I think, and we were slow, and now it's coming up. But I think the era of sensors will come, whether you talk about Israel, whether you talk about new technologies. We will have to go for sensors, both for moisture and for nutrient. And online mapping and variation in yield, soil nutrient management, this all can be done. Multi-utility vehicle mounted with nitrogen sensor and multi-spectral camera. So that, and here you see again for fertigation and spraying. Now these kind of technologies are now with the university. And this is with the support from ICER. So ICER has really built, is building up these infrastructure. Universities are, so the universities which are in forefront of thinking and have vision are able to adapt to this new technology. Future technologies will be, of course, poly house is a, now I call it an old technology. Sensors will come in a wholesome way, remote sensing, drone in agriculture. You see now, drones will be used for not only spraying, for spectral analysis, for decision support system, creating a database for crop growth, etc., robotics for weed management, crop management, and mobiles, you know. This is a slide for robotics. Harvesting, for example, for these robots, 8 hectares can be, acres can be harvested in one day by one robot. Now, this is going to be a revolutionary, reduce your costs. Weed management, this is a Blue River technology for weed control. Another, and then decision support system with the kind of computer, advanced computer technology, vision technology available, and with the robotics, I think the whole system is undergoing to go change. And we have to have all universities upfront in these technologies. Now, summing up, I would like to say that farming is becoming technology intensive, and challenge is to provide complete solution to the farmer. Artificial intelligence with the decision support system, computer vision technology is going to have major impact on increasing income sustainably. Genome editing is going to revolutionize development of high yielding varieties with resistance to biotic and antibiotic stresses and with nutritional quality. We'll need diverse technologies that are affordable and easily accessible. If we can take care of quality of human resource development, I think we will be able to meet all challenges of agriculture. They are not insurmountable. They are, whether it's a climate change, whether it's a biotic, abiotic stress, whether it's a water management, whether any kind of management, we'll be able to take care. With this, I like to thank each one of you. Thank Professor A.K. Singh for this wonderful invitation. It's a really a wonderful opportunity for me to talk on a subject which is dear to me, especially. And also wish to thank him for the nice words that he said. Please don't go by these words. I still like to be called as Dean and Joint Director of Education, IARI. That I consider to be the most important position where you shape the students of tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for such an excellent deliberation. May now request Dr. T.K. Behra, Professor, Division of Vegetable Science, to present formal vote of thanks.
Honorable chief guest, today's speaker, Professor S.L. Mehta, sir, from DDG Education, ICR, Director IRI, New Delhi, Dr. A.K. Singh, Dean and Joint Director of Education, Dr. Rashmi Agarwal, ma'am, the professors of the divisions, head of the divisions, students, and ladies and gentlemen. I really consider it a great privilege to propose a vote of thanks to all delegates in the webinar, what we have, and all of the senior members also here, the scientists, reputed scientists in this webinar is there, and naming so, Dr. Prabhu, chairperson of the PPBFRA, Professor P. Das, DDG Education, Dr. H.S. Gupta sir, former director, Dr. Anupam Verma, Dr. H.S. Gaur, Dr. Himanshu Pathak, Dr. D.K. Yadav, and many more are here and who have really witnessed this today's education day to make it a memorable and more successful event. So today, my words are not enough to express the gratitude to the chief guest and the speaker, Professor S.L. Mehta sir. On behalf of the Institute and my own behalf, I would like to profusely thank to our chief guest and speaker who graced this occasion with his kind thoughts and a lot of experiences, what he put it here. Also some reforms to be done for this new policy to develop for the new agriculture policy of India. I would like to thank our beloved directors, Dr. A.K. Singh for his words and kind support to organizing such event. We also ever remain grateful to you, sir. And many thanks for being with us for this today's function. I am also grateful to Madam Rashmi Agarwal, Dean Joint Director of Education, for providing encouragement and support for organizing such event. I heartily congratulate the students, those are participants today, the winners, and also the participants for this debate competitions today for their active participants in this program. And also I felt that to profusely thank the jury members, Dr. Selvi Praveen, Dr. D.K. Singh, Dr. R. Padaria, for their help to organizing the debate competitions and so just this event. My heartfelt thanks goes to all students, faculty members, professors, divisions, different divisions, project directors, coordinators, students, in presence of this, and their presence for this winner. We feel proud to thank each of you for making this, make us happy also with this, with your presence. My sincere thanks to Dr. Anil Shiroi, Dr. M.K. Burma, Dr. Burman, Dr. Ritu Jain, Dr. Harita, which is co-hosting this one, and all my colleagues who are directly or indirectly associated with this function. So thank you once and all very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. It was wonderful lecture and wonderful presentation.
Thank you very much.
And all this is not possible without we have our education system in place. We are discussing currently what will be the shape of education, particularly in the deemed to be university in ICR system, what role they will have to play. We have prepared some blueprint and I would like to discuss that with you in person. I will pass it on the details.
It will be a pleasure.
Right, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really very nice lecture, sir. Overall, everything you had covered, sir. Past and present, everything.
Das Babu.
Thank you.
Nice to see you, Dr. Pum.
Dr. Gaur.
Dr. Gaur, yeah.